mission trip and really just experience your love and just see all the goodness that you've been doing at Wildwood, God. I just pray that, that you would just really give me the right words to say so that I can really just share all of my experiences, and that I would just really be able to use those experiences to, just glorify you, God. And I just pray that as I speak, you would really just help me to focus on you, God, and that everyone here would just really be able to see all the good works that you've done. I just pray that I would decrease so that you can increase, God. And I just pray that you would speak through me and just give me courage to speak, and that that you would just take away all of my nervousness, God. And that I would just really be able to share this and just glorify you, God. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.
Amen.
Okay, so so this summer I went to Wildwood, New Jersey. I'll be answering some of these questions, like where, why, who, and what. So I'm so nervous right now. Sorry, my heart is like pounding so much now, but anyway. So pre-summer missions, like basically like how did I decide to go, I guess. So in college, I go to Cal Poly Pomona, and I just finished my first year last year, so I joined this Christian ministry called Epic Movement, and it's like an Asian American Christian fellowship. So through that, I was able to find this mission trip. So I went on winter conference back in January, and like they were promoting like their different mission trips and everything. So I think like I've always kind of wanted to go on a mission trip, like but I never really had like the opportunity to go. So initially like I really wanted to go somewhere like overseas and like international. When I went to a conference, I met this girl from UCSB, and she went to Wildwood last year. So like she started telling me about it, and like at first like I wasn't even interested in Wildwood like at all. I was like, why would I go somewhere like in a state, like that doesn't make any sense, like who's gonna be there that like I can reach out to? But then after she told me about her experiences, like I was just like really, like I just had like a change of heart, I guess. And then so then I applied and I got accepted, and then so then I started raising support, and then I'm super thankful for like our church and like everyone who supported me, because I had to raise like $3,200. That was a lot, and that was pretty scary at first, but like God definitely provided for me. Sorry, I'm running out of breath. I guess like other fears that I had prior to going on missions. So for this mission trip, like there's like different, like there's like Epic Movements like all over the US and like different college campuses. So for me, I was actually the only one from my school who went, so I guess that was like kind of scary, but to be honest, like I was kind of excited to like go alone too and like meet all those new people and everything. But I was kind of afraid, because I am definitely an introvert, and I was afraid that like, because I know that like for missions, like it's going to be super busy, and like you have to like, it's going to be like a really super busy schedule, so I was afraid of like having to like run around and like socialize with like everyone there and like meet so many new people, and I was like afraid that I would be burnt out by that. But I also had a lot of high expectations, because a lot of people that I talked to, they say that like summer missions, especially like in college or like with EPIC, like they told me that it's gonna be like the best summer ever, and like they really set like high expectations for me. And then I guess I kind of had the expectation that I would leave and then I would be like completely changed and like a new person. I'd be like super confident and everything, but that obviously like didn't happen to that extent. But yeah, I did have like high expectations prior to missions. So the next question is where? So where the heck is Wildwood? I can't really see it, but so Wildwood, New Jersey is all the way on the east coast, and then, yeah, it took a while to get there, because the closest airport is in Atlantic City, and I had to take, like, 3 flights to get there, because it's a pretty small airport. But, yeah, Wildwood is all the way at the tip of New Jersey, and, yeah, you can't really see that, but when, like, before I went there, I had no idea that Wildwood was an island, so yes, I was stuck there for like 2 months, but yes. And we had like limited transportation too, or like, yeah, we didn't have any cars, so we had to walk within like that, like, I don't know, like 30 blocks or so. But yeah, and then we lived there in Crescent Court. Yeah. So why is Wildwood so significant? So there is like a big, Wildwood is known for their beaches and everything and like the boardwalk. And there's also this really big amusement park there called Maury's Piers. So on the boardwalk there's like 3 piers with like amusement parks. So it's like Santa Monica Pier times 3, I guess. And then they're kind of known for hiring international students who go there to work. So yeah, there's international students who go on a J-1 visa, and they basically have to work for 3 months, and then they get to travel in America for 1 month. So yeah, it's pretty cool, because instead of like going out to different countries or like going out internationally, like we're all together from like different backgrounds and nationalities, but we're all together like in the same place. So we reach out to those people, and then when they go home, they get to spread the gospel with people back at home. So that's pretty cool, I think. Am I talking too fast?
No.
Okay. Okay. And then who did I work with? For our mission trip, we had 32 students from all over the U.S. And a lot of them were from Texas or California or Pennsylvania and like all over the U.S. And then we also had 20 staff members who were also working on all of those different campuses. Yeah. And then this is just all the students.
Selfie.
Yeah. And then, so yeah, I spent 8 weeks there, so what did I actually do for those 8 weeks? So for a lot of you, I don't know, you probably thought like I was just on the beach all the time, which is partially true, but yeah, we did a lot of things. Our schedule, well, we can't see that either, but we had a pretty busy schedule. There's supposed to be something on the side, but yeah. So we're pretty busy. So a big part of our mission is to work there. So we kind of evangelize through the context of work. So the whole point was to get a job there and then evangelize to our coworkers, which were the international students. So I got a job at a donut shop called Fractured Prune. and I was on the boardwalk. So, yeah, this is my first job, and like it was actually pretty hard finding a job there, because like even though there are so many like shops and everything, but then like I don't know, they're all just like weren't hiring, or like they didn't like our schedule or something. But yeah, for our mission, like all of our activities are at night, so we could only work until 5 p.m. every day, except Saturdays we could work till 1. So yeah, I guess like it was pretty hard finding a job because they're pretty busy at night, so they didn't like our schedule. But in general, for me, I actually wasn't that busy for work. I worked like 3 times a week, about like 4 hours a day. And I had like either morning shift or afternoon shift. So if it was in the morning, then I'd have to work from like 8 or 7-ish to like 12. And then in the afternoon, I worked like 1 to 5. And then we kind of did everything there, like dipping donuts and cashier and like making drinks and cleaning and stuff. And then they believe in like fresh, hot hand dipped donuts. So we had to take the donuts out of like the burning hot oil, and like, yes, it was very painful, but yeah. And we had like paper thin gloves, but yeah, I mean, my fingers got used to it after a while, but yeah, it was painful. And yeah, so I ate like way too much sweets this summer, but pretty sure I gained at least 5 pounds, if not more. But yeah, so we had work every day, and then at nighttime would be our activities. So since our week or our mission started on Wednesdays, every week began on a Wednesday, which is kind of weird, but that's just how we did it. So yeah, so on Wednesdays, we had our weekly meetings. So we had like an icebreaker or worship, and then message, and then more worship. And then every week we'd have like a new theme for the week. So it would be like facing the giants, or like all for one, or I don't remember all the other ones, but yeah, we just had like a theme for the week. And then after meeting, we had something called Boardwalk Blitz. So that's when we went out to the boardwalk to evangelize to the people there at night. So we'd always go with a partner, like one guy and one girl. And then we literally just go into the boardwalk and then like find people to talk to and have like spiritual conversations with. And then we had like different tools that we used to start those conversations, which is on the next slide, but yeah. And then there's me and my partner, Jerry, and then that was actually one of the people that we talked to, and he actually prayed to receive Christ as well, so yeah, that was super exciting. And then these are some of the tools that we used for spreading the gospel and initiating spiritual conversation. So we use this thing called this Quest Survey. So they just ask like questions about like person's life, and like it leads into more like spiritual questions, I guess. So it starts with like, what 3 words would you use to describe your life? And then like, what do you think happens after death? And then yeah, so like spiritual questions. And then we also use perspective cards, which ask questions about like one's beliefs and like their spiritual worldview. And then it's kind of like a more visual way of presenting the gospel. And then one of my favorites is solarium. So these are just like random pictures, but we would like ask the person like choose like a picture that like describes your life, and then usually like you could kind of get to know like a person more, like anything that they're like struggling with or like where they're at in their life. So that also leads to spiritual conversation. To present the gospel, we had this booklet, a that's called the Knowing God Personally book, and yeah, it just presents the gospel in like four simple points. So yeah, those are all the tools that we use. And then on Thursday we had family dinner. So we all ate dinner together, and then it would usually be like bring your own dinner, so we'd all have to make our own dinner, and then we just eat together. And then after that we had family time. So these are like different like activities that we did to just like bond us together as a family. So one time we did something called a privilege walk, and then other times we made dinner together. And then we did the whisper challenge once, and then we did like other like team building activities on the beach. And then on Friday, we had our outreach event. So outreach and evangelism team would plan like an event. And it would usually be like an open event where we can invite our coworkers and like other people that we met to kind of just like hang out with us. So one time we had a culture night, and then we had like a potluck and bowling. So yeah, they're just like fun activities for us to invite people to. And then Saturday night, we still had work in the morning, but then in the afternoon, we had, it would like alternate. So one week we'd have family development time, and then the next week we'd have men's and women's time. So for family development time, sometimes we have like more speakers and messages. And stuff like that. But then in the picture, one time we did a feet washing ceremony, so that was really cool, and like it was just like a way for us to practice our servant leadership. And then for men's and women's time, we would split up, and then I'm not really sure what the guys did, I just know they did a lot of physical activities. It was pretty rough. But for the girls, we had like a lot of discussions, and yeah, we talked a lot. And yeah, for both men's and women's, like we just kind of took that time to just learn more about what it means to be men and women of God, and how we can use like those specific strengths and roles to serve God in that way. And then on Sunday we had church. So for us, we had a lot of people in our mission, so we didn't want to like invade one church. So we split into two churches, and the one I went to was called St. Simeon's Episcopal Church. So Wildwood is pretty small, and like no one really lives there, so there weren't like a lot of churches within like walking distance. So this was just one that we went to, and it was completely different from what we're used to here. Like, yeah, we had like a lot of different like books that we used. Like there was like a book of common prayer, and like we, for worship, like it was hymns only, and then it was like only with one organ, so it was pretty different. And then every week we had communion, and we used real wine, so that was interesting. Wow. And then our service was like only about an hour altogether, so it was pretty short. And then Sunday, of course, was our Sabbath day, so we could finally rest after like a really busy week. It was fun to just like hang out with everyone and not have to work. And then Monday night, we had action group, which is like Bible study. So that's my action group. And we kind of just went through these nine elements of commitments and leadership and reproducing leaders. So these are just the topics that we went through. We only had 8 weeks, so I guess they confined the 9 into 8. But Yeah, it was just like Bible study. And then Tuesday night was my favorite night because it was date night with Jesus. This was basically just like quiet time that we had with the Lord, so we could do like whatever we wanted or go wherever we wanted to do this. But for me, I always went to the beach, and every time, oh, you can't really see it, but there were just like really nice sunsets, and yeah, the beach was just really nice there. You can't really see it in the pictures, but I was definitely reminded of God's love through the nature and everything around me. Like, just seeing like the ocean or the skies, it just really reminded me of like how great and how vast God's love for us is. And yeah, it was just really nice there. And then after that, we had prayer and worship. It was nice to just like come back from your time with God and just like worship together. So yeah, that was my favorite night. And then the week starts all over again, and then we do the same thing 8 times. But then after every night, we kind of did, like, this was kind of our own thing that we did. Like, it wasn't required or anything, but we just thought like it would be nice to share our testimonies together. So every night after all of our activities, we would just like one or two people would share their testimonies, and then we'd all pray for them together. So yeah, that was really like a time where I felt like we all were like united and like a family together, and we prayed together. And then through all of that, there were definitely some challenges as well. So for our mission, after like week 3, the staff actually had to leave us. So like it was actually part of the mission for them to leave and like for us to lead ourselves. So we were given like their leadership responsibilities. So there were different committees, I guess you can call it. So there was like lead team, action group leaders, leaders for weekly meeting, prayer and worship, and like all of those different activities for the week. With that, there was definitely some pride and like feeling of like hierarchy, of course, with like which leadership positions you were placed in. There's just this poem that one of my teammates shared with us, and I thought like it really captured like the kind of like the sense of like pride or like how spiritual warfare can get to us internally. This is just part of the poem that I got related to it, but this is how it goes. So it says, "I would intoxicate you with the mission of God rather than God himself. Then you would worship a cause instead of Jesus. You would fight each other to have the most important goals. You would burn out from striving. You would think that success is measured by the results you see. You would build platforms for applause rather than to display God. Then all your time and effort would be spent on becoming important rather than on knowing Jesus and loving people. The goals would be to gather followers, earn fancy job titles, publish books, build big ministries rather than to seek the souls of men and the glory of God." So I thought that was definitely something that was prevalent through our mission, even though like conflicts were resolved, but definitely in all of us, there's definitely pride in us through the leadership positions that we have. So for me, I was action group leader, so I think I did have some pride in that, and like it did seem kind of like above some people who were serving in like a other committees, so yeah, like that was something that I kind of struggled with also. And then there was also a lot of self-doubt through leading as well, because for me, like, I'm definitely the most, like, quiet and soft-spoken person in my group, for my action group, so I was like, why am I leading? But yeah, like, throughout that, like, I kind of had to learn to, like, find my voice and, like, have courage in that, and, like, trust God that, like, He's the one leading me and that I'm not the one leading. Yeah, and then there was also struggles with evangelism as well. Like, for me, it was pretty hard to evangelize to my coworkers because most of them were, like, high school students, kind of. But, like, they're a lot younger than in most other jobs. So it was kind of hard to, like, get along with them and, like, try to talk about, like, serious, like, religious stuff. But, yeah, I think I learned that was kind of, like, besides the point. My point really was just to, like, develop relationships with them first, and then if there is, like, right opportunity, then, like, we can evangelize to them. But, yeah, I think evangelism at first was pretty hard. Yeah. And then just other challenges, like self-care, and, like, balancing time and work, and, like, wanting to hang out with everyone, and, yeah, I was pretty busy all the time, so it's kind of hard to, like, keep yourself healthy and, like, spend time with the Lord, too. But through all that, what did I learn? So there's this verse that I felt really resonated with me throughout the whole mission. When my discipler actually shared this with me, and she said that when she read it, like, it reminded her of me. So, I think, like I said before, like, I am usually, like, pretty soft-spoken, and I'm, like, pretty gentle and, like, quiet and everything. So, I think that was something that I struggled with, like, all throughout my life. So, I think through this mission, like, I really learned how I could use that, or how God can use that through me. So one of my friends shared with me that for me, like, we're all created in God's image, and I guess she said that, like, my voice can be, like, representative of, like, God's voice, how, like, God's voice is gentle and quiet, but it's also strong in strength and in spirit. I think throughout, like, the mission of, like, meeting and interacting with other people, like, I found that I can actually be comfortable in my introversion, and, yeah, just especially in our world of, like, having to be extroverted and loud and talkative and, like, super out there, I think, there's definitely a lot of strength in introversion and in gentleness too, I guess. And so I learned that, like, God really does use us in exactly the way that He makes us, and, yeah, He does have a purpose for all those things that He gave specifically to us. And then there's also this thing called the growth model that I learned. So it's grace plus truth plus time equals growth. So I think, like I said before, like, I really expected to, like, come out of this mission and be, like, completely, like, a new person and, like, super confident and all of that. But I think what I was missing was the time aspect of it. I think it's not gonna happen just, like, immediately like that. Like, I learned that, like, growing takes time, and I can't expect to just be changed, like, within a matter of, like, 2 months or, like, however long. But, yeah, I think, I was just reminded that to grow, like, we really do need all three of these things. And yeah, there's just the parable of the unfruitful fig tree that kind of represents, like, growth with all those three aspects. So through those 2 months, we had our evangelism staff. So for initiated conversations, we had 399. So these would just be like, where if we go up to like people on the boardwalk and like we ask them like, hey, do you want to do like a spiritual survey or like something like that? And that could be whether or not they say yes or no. And then spiritual conversations is if we actually do talk about anything religious with them. So we had 215 spiritual conversations, and then we had 45 gospel presentations and 11 new believers. And I know, like, it might seem like only 11, like, that doesn't seem like a lot, honestly, but I think I forgot to put it in the PowerPoint, but there is like a scale of like from negative 10 to positive 10. So like negative 10 would be like they're atheist and like they're super shy and like not believing in anything. And then 10 would be like they're completely like spiritually like there and like have really strong personal relationship with God. So even though like they all might not be like on the positive side yet, like, you never know when, like, those spiritual conversations can, like, turn a negative 8 into, like, a negative 2. So, yeah, like, I think I just learned, like, it's not really about having them, like, convert or, like, become Christian, but sometimes it does take more than one conversation to, I guess, like, get them to start thinking about it more. And one important thing that I learned is that successful evangelism is just simply taking the initiative to share Christ in the power of the Holy Spirit and leaving the results to God. So, yeah, like, a lot of times, like, we would go out and, like, a lot of people would say no, like, when we want to talk to them, but it's not about what we're doing or what we're saying, but it's really just leaving the results to God and like letting him take control of where he wants the conversations to go. So yeah. I guess I talked kind of fast, but that's kind of the end of it. And I have a video that kind of like that someone on my team made, and yeah, I think it just captured like the fun and fellowship and like everything that we did really well. So yeah, there's probably stuff in there that I didn't talk about that you'll see, but yeah, you can ask questions later, I guess.
Yeah. So wonderful, then you want to share it. And that's the part that all of us should have. Now, God's going to give opportunities. Now, we may not be able to go to far places like Wildwood or maybe even different countries. But God says we start at home. We start in our schools. So if there's any opportunity that you can share your faith, you should do it. Because God gives it. But if you don't grab onto it, God will keep giving it to you. So at school, if you have an opportunity to talk to your friends about Christ, you should. Or if you have an opportunity to invite them to church because you're shy to talk about it, then bring them here. Other people will talk to them about it. So opportunity starts around you. You don't have to go far, but eventually God does send you to different places. Because once you go to different places, the person that learns the most is you. Now, a lot of times we think if we go to different places and we're going to make a big difference for those people that we go to. The answer is no. You learn the most. And for those people, both those of us who've been to mission trips, you could attest to that. You learn so much, and God humbles you so much that you give all glory to God. So, my challenge for all of you is this. After listening to what Agnes shared, if you guys want that kind of feeling, then start here. Start here by sharing the gospel, by sharing your faith, and you're gonna have a good time. And you're gonna want to do more. Okay? Alright, so that's a challenge for all of you. Now, I'm happy to be back. Looks like if I go for 2 to 3 weeks, more people show up. So maybe I should go out more often. So, Josh, did you already introduce people who came up? From?
Yeah, so.
Okay, and you've been here before, right? I've seen you.
Me?
Yeah.
No?
Some.